Good morning, children, and a very happy new year to all of you. I hope you had a fantastic Christmas holidays with your family and friends. Today, I would like you to introduce to the new topic that we are going to take is the Acts of the Apostles. We see that this book is the continuation of the Gospel of Luke. Now, we will begin a short story and then we'll continue with our lesson. Once, a village carpenter was attracted by a TV advertisement on the most amazing power saw. The advertisement said that this power saw can cut the wood 10 times more than a normal saw. The carpenter thought that this power saw will make his work easier. So he went to the shop and bought the power saw. And when he was using the power saw, it was not working the way it was shown on the TV. And he got worried. He thought that if this is not working the way it has shown on the TV, it is of no use for me and I should return it back. The next morning, he went to the salesperson and he said that the power saw is not working. The salesman had a look. He pulled a nylon cord and there was life back into the saw. Looking at that, the carpenter was shocked. The salesman then demonstrated it to the carpenter and it worked as it was shown in the advertisement. Now, as you have heard the story, I would like you to discuss the questions in your group. How is it that the village carpenter, after so much of experience, did not know about the cord? How does this story compare with what happens in your own life? Do you think someone has played the role of the salesman in your life? Who? When you look at the life of your parish church, do you think this power has indeed been released? Why or why not? Today we'll see a story of the Acts of the Apostles, where we see such a power released and how the church was formed. After rising from the dead, Jesus met with his disciples, giving convincing proof that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. Once, while eating with them, Jesus commanded them, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which I have spoken about. John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." One day, when Jesus was with them on the Mount of Olives, he told them, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the rest of the world." After Jesus said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. While Jesus was carrying his ministry on, he chose 12 apostles who will continue his ministry after him. These 12 apostles would represent the 12 tribes of Israel and would ultimately replace the Jewish leaders. The choice of the apostle was an act of Jesus guided by the will of the Father. So he prays the whole night before he appoints them. Jesus gives his own authority as leaders of the new Israel. So the 12 apostles signifies the unity and integrity of the new Israel, which had to be restored. So as Jesus told his followers, they returned to Jerusalem and met each other regularly for prayers. Once Peter stood up in the crowd of around 120 believers to talk about replacement for Judas, who had betrayed Jesus and died. Peter said, "The replacement must be chosen from those who had been with Jesus from the time he was baptized by John to his resurrection. The new apostle would be a witness to the fact that Jesus was alive." Two men were chosen. One was Joseph, who was called Barsabbas, also known as Justus, and the another one was Matthias. They prayed, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which of these two you have chosen to take over from Judas." Then they cast lots. And from the lots, name came out of Matthias, and he joined the other 11 apostles, making a total of 12. So after Matthias was among the 12, the disciples used to meet each other every day and pray to the Holy Spirit. And on the day of Pentecost, Holy Spirit came upon them like a tongues of fire. Let us watch the video to know what really happened.
It's 50 days since Passover, the day Jesus was crucified. Now thousands of Jewish pilgrims come to Jerusalem for the festival of Pentecost.
Any sign of Jesus' followers?
No. I assume they've all gone back to Galilee.
Do you? Just make sure your men are ready. If they return, you have to deal with them. I cannot call upon the Romans again.
Glad you're here, brother. This way. We must be careful, though. They're watching us.
John. I'm glad you're all safe. It's good to see you again, Stephen. Matthew.
What form will it take? When will it come? Jesus said all we had to do is ask. I have been asking. Every day.
The Holy Spirit will come when the time is right. I think we should pray together. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Languages.
The Holy Spirit. He is with us.
There were three great feasts that bounded all the neighboring Jews to visit the temple in Jerusalem. They were the Passover, the Feast of the Tabernacles, and the Feast of Pentecost, which was also known as Feast of Weeks. So the Feast of Pentecost was there before the Holy Spirit could come. So the term Pentecost comes from the Greek word Pentecoste, meaning 50. This day was also commemorated as the giving of the Ten Commandments to Moses on Mount Sinai. It refers to the Jewish festival celebrated on the 50th day after the Passover, also known as the Feast of Weeks. And this festival was also called as the Feast of Harvest and the Day of the First Fruits. So as we saw in our video, that on the day of Pentecost, the disciples were gathered together in prayer. There was a mighty gush of wind. The Holy Spirit descended on them in tongues of fire, and they were filled with power and were given the gifts of tongues. So, children, we need to understand that Holy Spirit was not born on the day of Pentecost. He is eternally God. And there are Old Testament stories which speaks about him several times. The Holy Spirit have spoken through the prophets. Holy Spirit also spoke through David. And we have seen that the Holy Spirit in the New Testament has spoken through Stephen as well, the first martyr. And we saw how Jewish people have been opposing the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit acts and reveals himself in every age. But it is true that at the day of Pentecost, there was a fresh outpouring and something great happened. And from that day, the Holy Spirit became the dominant reality in the church and continues to be so even today. Now, children, let us understand the gift of tongues. It is probably unlikely that the apostles spoke in some foreign languages that day. Almost every Jew understood Aramaic or Greek. But speaking in tongues really meant pouring out an unintelligible sound in no known languages, which signified that these words were directly inspired by the Holy Spirit. It was probably the reason why the apostles were thought to have gone mad or were said to be drunk with wine. But the truth was that for the first time in their lives, this crowd of different nationalities had heard a message that struck directly at their hearts. We saw how the power of the Holy Spirit had enabled the disciple to preach a message that every person could understand. This scene also reminds us of the story of Babel in the Old Testament, where the nations were divided by division of languages. Luke wants us to tell us that now every nation under the sun is united by a common language. The new Israel gathers the nations in unity. And this scene is also very prophetic. The wind of the Spirit will scatter the disciples to all nations, to the ends of the earth, and the gospel will be proclaimed to all people in their own languages. Thus, Luke's Pentecostal story depicts the birth of the church and its future mission. After the Holy Spirit filled the disciples of Jesus with his power, Peter stepped out to the crowd and gave his first sermon. After listening to Peter's sermon, 3,000 people from the crowd got baptized. In Peter's sermon, we see some essential teachings. That Jesus is the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecy. Peter stresses on the prophetic announcement and their fulfillment implies that God is in control of history and nothing happens in an haphazard manner. He also says that Jesus is the promised Messiah and his life fulfills all the messianic prophecies, and with him a new age has begun. Peter portrays the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. that he was a descendant of David, that Jesus taught in the synagogue like a master, he worked miracles, he was crucified, died, rose from the dead, and is now seated at the right hand of God. Peter also says that we all are called to accept Jesus as the Messiah and Lord. We see Peter heals a lame man, and it is the first of the many signs and wonders spoken of by the prophets. It confirms the great power of those who call on the name of Jesus. Peter's miracle patterns the one of Jesus, showing the mission of Jesus is carried on in the church, and the church is now the continuing presence of Jesus who carries on his power in his name. After this sign and wonder, Peter got arrested. Once again, the authorities, that is, the scribe and Pharisees, were concerned. They arrested Peter and his disciple, brought them before the Sanhedrin, that is the Jewish court, and strictly warned them to stop preaching. But Peter courageously spoke out, "You must judge whether in the sight of God it is right to listen to you rather than God, or we are unable not to speak the things we have seen and heard." Let us see the significance of our today's story. Filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, the apostles carried on the mission of Jesus. The early Christians bore witness to Jesus by their lives. The preaching of the apostles was accompanied by signs and wonders. The attractive characteristic of the early Christians were their fellowship, their worship, the sharing of their goods and possessions, their obedience to those in authority, and their love and concern for everyone. The apostles were not afraid of being arrested or imprisoned and spoke courageously about Jesus. And so the word increased and the disciples multiplied. The church does spread all through Jerusalem like fire. So we see church as a community of believers. The community of believers was one heart and mind, and no one claimed that any of his possessions was his own, but they had everything in common. A witnessing church. All day long, both at the temple and in their homes, they did not stop teaching and proclaiming Jesus as God's anointed one. A sacramental church. The church was a sign to all people of the indwelling presence of Jesus. They experienced his presence in the breaking of bread and their fellowship. They radiated this presence to others and thus enjoyed the favor of all the people. They were thus a sacrament, an outward sign of God's indwelling presence. An institutional church. From the very beginning, the church was like other organizations. It had official and people in authority. And even today, it has ordained ministers who administer the sacraments and carry out the day-to-day governance. The highest authority is Peter. In today's, his successor is the Pope, our Pope Francis, who is Christ's visible representative. Peter was assisted by the elders, in today's time, like our bishops, and they in turn were assisted by deacons. A serving church. The church serves others by caring for their spiritual and temporal needs. The early Christians spend their lives by healing, comforting, forgiving, welcoming, teaching, feeding, and loving. Now, we'll have a quick recap of what we have learned today.
One of the earliest accounts about Jesus of Nazareth, his life, death, and resurrection, was written by a man named Luke.
We know it as the Gospel of Luke, but Luke continued the story in a second volume,
called the Book of Acts, and it's all about what Jesus continued to do after his resurrection.
Acts begins with the disciples, who are hanging out with Jesus, who's just come back to life, which is mind-blowing to imagine.
And then for weeks, the risen Jesus kept teaching them about his upside-down kingdom, the new creation that he launched through his death and resurrection.
This is exciting stuff, and the disciples are ready to go tell the world.
But then Jesus tells them to wait, and to stay in Jerusalem until they receive a new kind of power, so they can be faithful witnesses to Jesus and his kingdom. Then he says that their mission is going to begin in Jerusalem, then move out to Judea and Samaria, and then from there out into the nations. It's like a roadmap for the whole book of Acts. Then the disciples saw Jesus enthroned as king of all creation.
So the disciples wait, wondering when this power is going to come. And then comes the time of Pentecost.
So this is an ancient Israelite festival. It's during the early summer, and thousands of Jewish pilgrims would come back to Jerusalem from all over the world, all these different languages and cultures colliding in the city.
And the disciples are together in a house, which is suddenly filled with rushing wind along with fire. Fire splinters off into tongues of fire hovering over people's heads. What's this all about?
Yeah, so Luke is tapping into a repeated Old Testament theme. When God's presence showed up similarly at Mount Sinai, he made a covenant with Israel and gave them the Ten Commandments. Then later, when God's glory came in a pillar of fire, it filled the tabernacle when he came to live among them.
That was just one pillar of fire, not many.
Exactly. Luke's making an important point here. This is God's personal temple presence, God's spirit that was foretold by Israel's prophets. And now it's come to take up residence in the new temple of Jesus' body, that is, his people. They've become little mobile temples where God now dwells.
And they start to tell stories about Jesus, but they're speaking in languages that they didn't know before, yet all the visitors can understand them. What's this all about?
Well, Peter gets up to explain that this is the fulfillment of Israel's hopes based on the scriptures. God's plan was always to use the unified family of Abraham to bring peace and justice to the world. But the tribes of Israel had been scattered because of the exile. Now, here at Pentecost, representatives from all of the tribes come back together and they're introduced to their Messiah, the crucified and risen Jesus, so they can now become the restored people of Israel.
And thousands of them start following the way of Jesus.
Which brings us to Luke's tale of two temples. So you've got the temple that Herod built in Jerusalem, where Jesus' disciples worship like the rest of the Israelites. But now there's also Jesus' temple, which consists of people. This temple's meeting together in homes all over Jerusalem, and they were approaching life in a radical new way.
Right, think about it. Many of these pilgrims aren't even from Jerusalem, so they formed these new families, and they're all depending on each other.
Yeah, people would sell their stuff, provide for the poor among them. They ate their meals together. They said their daily prayers together.
They were learning from the apostles what it meant to live as if Jesus is the true king of the world. And it must have been exhilarating.
Children, it's time for the word of God. I would like you to relax yourself. Close your eyes, take a deep breath in, and let it out. Children, just imagine that you were with the disciples in the upper room, and you are praying for Holy Spirit. Now, attentively hear to the Word of God. A reading from the book of Acts of the Apostle. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Children, keep your eyes closed and let us reflect on what we have heard in our today's reading. We see how the disciples were gathered in the upper room to receive the Holy Spirit. Some of the disciples were feeling fearful. Some of them had doubts of when will we receive the Holy Spirit. Luke describes the coming of the Holy Spirit with symbols of tongues of fire rested on them and wind blowing. Holy Spirit coming as fire and wind, which means that the Spirit transforms and renews. And we see the transformation in the disciples as they were fearful and doubtful in the beginning. But as soon as they received the Holy Spirit, they became bold witnesses of Jesus. In today's time, we receive the Holy Spirit at the sacrament of baptism and confirmation. And we see that the Holy Spirit guides the church today through their ministries, that is, hospitality ministry, teaching ministry, counseling ministry, and outreach ministries. Now, children, let us close our eyes and pray to the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit preside in you, and pray that the Holy Spirit guides you in your day-to-day life, as it guided the apostles and the church. Now, let us listen to the hymn, Come Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, come with your fire. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, come with your fire. Holy Spirit, come with your fire. Holy Spirit, let your fire fall.
Children, kindly open your eyes. And now it's time for the spiritual task of the week. I would like you to write a prayer to the Holy Spirit for the needs of your church, family members, friends, and for yourself. And once you have completed the prayer, then submit it to your catechism teacher. Thank you, children. I hope you have learned a lot in today's class. And if you like the class, please share what you have learned with your parents, relatives, and friends. Have a nice week.